Good afternoon. A woman has died and her ex-husband has been charged with murder after she was found unresponsive inside a home in Bexley last night. 30-year-old Amira Mooney was a mother of three who moved to Sydney from Lebanon more than a decade ago. Neighbours shocked to hear of her death.
It's shocking to know that someone passed away, and I hope it doesn't happen again.
Police arrested 39-year-old Ahmad Hodroj at the property. He faced court this morning and did not apply for bail. And if you or anyone you know is a victim of domestic violence, there is help available. Call 1-800-RESPECT. That is 1-800-737-732. A fire has broken out inside the Villawood Detention Centre in Sydney's west. Firefighters arrived just before 11:30 this morning. While staff placed mattresses underneath windows, some detainees were forced to jump to safety.
You got to jump out. You got to jump.
Is it just you two up there?
Yeah. Only us two because we're in the room.
Enough, give mattresses.
Wait, go get my shoes, man.
Let's go!
Jump. More than 20 people have been treated for smoke inhalation, including detainees, staff and first responders. It's believed the fire was deliberately lit. There are dramas on the city's rail network just in time for the commute home. Trains are not running on the western lines between Parramatta and St Mary's and Blacktown to Richmond due to staffing issues. Replacement buses have been arranged, but officials are warning commuters to prepare for delays. Delays are also affecting the North Sydney line. The burden of childcare on families has been laid bare in a new report showing the cost has shot up by as much as 32% in 4 years. Federal politics reporter Eliza Edwards joins us from Canberra. Eliza, fees are growing faster than inflation.
They sure are, Lizzie. The consumer watchdog has been tasked with examining the scale of childcare fee increases. Its interim analysis has been handed down and it shows that fees rose between 20 and 32% over 4 years. That's substantially higher than wages growth and inflation over the same period. And the ACCC will now look at whether the price hikes have been justified. For instance, if the costs of providing childcare services by centres have increased at the same rate as fees. This report has dropped just a few days before higher childcare subsidies take effect. This has been a key policy from the Albanese government. The Prime Minister has promised the policy will benefit 1.2 million families and save some of them thousands of dollars a year. But the opposition is questioning whether the savings may just be eaten up by higher fees.
I think what that interim report does, is confirm that increasing the childcare subsidy to give families that much needed cost of living relief was the right thing to do.
What we've seen is families losing that increase to fee rises, and so some families, in fact, are worse off.
The higher subsidies are due to kick in from Monday, Lizzie. Once that happens, the ACCC says it will monitor the impact on fees and the behaviour of childcare providers to ensure there's no price gouging.
Eliza Edwards there in Canberra. Residents of the Jenin refugee camp are rebuilding after the largest scale military operation by Israeli forces in the West Bank in 20 years. At least 12 Palestinians were killed in the operation and nearly 80% of homes in the camp have been damaged. United Nations experts say the military raids targeting the camp should be considered a war crime. At least 15 people have died in severe flooding in southwest China. Torrential downpours have battered the city of Chongqing, a region of 31 million people. Pictures show a multi-story building toppling into the river while rescue teams work overtime to get villagers to safety. Plans to change a concert cap for the SCG and Allianz Stadium precinct have been met with resistance from some locals with concerns the increased noise could have mental health impacts. The proposal suggests raising the average number of concerts allowed per year from 4 to 20. There are suggestions to offer locals subsidised or free ticketing to events to alleviate the issues. Well, it's official. El Nino is here after the World Meteorological Organization recorded the hottest ever average global temperatures this week. And while we won't feel it yet, Australia is heading for a very hot and dry spell. For more, New South Wales Rural Fire Service Commissioner Rob Rogers joins me. Commissioner, thanks for your time. Warmer and dry weather means more risk of bushfires. What is the RFS doing to prepare for this summer?
Good afternoon, Lizzie. Based on, obviously, we've had 3 wet years, we're way behind on hazard reduction. So I guess some of the things that RFS, along with other agencies, are doing is trying to get as much hazard reduction done as we can ahead of the fire season. So whenever it's dry, you'll start seeing a lot more smoke in the air. The other thing we're doing, obviously, we've got more aircraft we're bringing online, we've got more trucks we're rolling out, more technology, but it's about us being ready for that fire season, but it's also the community. So we're doing our part, we're doing everything we possibly can to reduce the risk and then be ready to respond to fires. What we really need is the community to play their part, you know, clean out their gutters and do all those things we tell them to do each and every year.
After some prolonged days of extreme heat, well, they are forecast. Could we see something similar to the Black Summer fires this season?
Look, I guess I don't have a crystal ball, but I don't believe so. Just because we aren't on the back of 3 years of drought, which is what we had before. But the difference is we've got a lot of grass risk that we didn't have any grass before. So it's just a different risk, but I don't expect that we're going to see that level of fire activity, you know, in areas like the South Coast and the like that obviously suffered so much. It's a significant risk, but I don't think it's quite to that level of the 2019-20 fire season. Obviously I hope that doesn't come back again anytime soon.
Yeah, we do too. In the meantime, is there anything we can do to prepare for El Nino?
So I think people probably haven't had much focus on fire for the last few years because they've been focused on storms and floods. So, I mean, it's dusting out off their bushfire survival plan, making sure they've cleaned out their gutters and all those things, and make sure the family know what they're going to do if fire threatens your home. If you live in a bushfire prone area, and there's plenty of them up and down the urban areas, up and down the coast, make sure you have that plan, make sure everybody knows what they're going to do, and just do those simple preparation things and can improve the chances of your property surviving significantly.
Great advice. Rob Rogers from the RFS, thank you for your time on the afternoon news.
Thanks, Lizzie.
An investigation is underway after nude images of more than 45 current and former AFL players were shared online. Justine Conway has the latest.
Well, the AFL Integrity Unit launched an investigation on Tuesday, alerting police and the E-Safety Commission. That is when the sordid Google Drive came to light, shaming 45 past and present players, including Brownlow medalists. The data, though, has yet to be verified for identification.
We don't know where these images originated from. We don't know where they've gone to or who has copies.
The E-Safety Commission did move quickly and the images have been taken down.
These images, like all image-based abuse images, represent a profound violation of trust and a profound intrusion into the privacy of the people who are depicted.
The AFL says it's unaware of a motive and is working to support the players and is working closely with their clubs.
I just don't want to give it any one bit of oxygen. It's not. Just put yourself in their shoes.
We'll always support our players and acknowledge they make mistakes and work through that with them.
Certainly there's a lot of advice from AFL clubs around a lot of areas and this one is no different.
While the E-Safety Commission is continuing to investigate the source of the leak, police will only act and can only act if the players come forward and make a statement. At this stage, they say they've received no reports.
A quick check of the weather. Right now it is 16 degrees at Sydney Harbour, 17 degrees at the airport. Around the country tomorrow it will be a sunny day in Brisbane, heading for a top of 22 degrees. Sunshine ahead for Sydney, 18 the top. Melbourne can expect a shower or two, 15 the top there. A partly cloudy day on the way for Hobart, 13 degrees. Showers and becoming windy in Adelaide, 15. Showers for Perth heading for 19. Sunshine and 33 degrees in Darwin.